Glad you're here, and several people are prepared to sing and share. Kevin's out of the hospital. Y'all remember, pray for Callie. She's still in the hospital. Her calcium levels are low, so he's out there with his family. And I'll introduce Stephen in just a moment, and he's going to share with us. He's been encouraging me each Wednesday morning at 5:45. Stephen and Danny and a young man who grew up over, Seth Kendrick, grew up over Chapel Hill when we were there, meet and talk about the Lord. They do a study together, and I've been to a couple of those. It's been encouraging to me, and he kind of shared his story, and he got him in trouble, so I asked him to come out here. So we'll say more about that in a minute. Let's pray, and remember, pray for Callie and her family, and then Michelle will be having some news this week about kind of what direction to go. And y'all mentioned several others, Will's grandmother this morning, and let's pray for them. Anybody else? Harry's going to be having some tests this week, I think, aren't you?
Yeah.
Right, Captain? Whatever's going to happen. All right, let's pray. Father, we thank you for the opportunity to be together this evening. We pray, Lord, you bless those who sing, and we pray you bless Stephen as he shares his story with us about what you're doing in his life. And I pray, Lord, for these who have special needs tonight, for Callie as she recovers, and the calcium problems she's having issues with, and for Michelle as she seeks your will about her life, for Will's grandmother, Lord, you lift her up and encourage her. And Lord, again, we thank you for this time together in Jesus' name. Amen. Loretta?
positive.
You're hitting down each other then.
Good.
You win it.
No, I'm just saying. I remember this one. Yeah.
Tongue can accuse and carry.
pull it down, and he pulled it back down to normal?
It was set to normal.
Okay, good. If it was up one step for me, I wouldn't be able to see it. Thank you.
God will make this trial a blessing, and the whole of my world will see.
every child of God, this test he must face. It is here that God will mold you and make you what you ought to be. God will make this trial a blessing. Just be patient, you will see. Standing on the mountain, looking back, I can see. When I was in the lowest valley, his strong hand was leading me. Oh, it's good to see the sunshine and to taste sweet victory. God has made this trial a blessing.
Study for about the past 10 years of how Jesus impacted the world. And I said, if this was a strategy I would throw out to you, it'd be impacting our community and world through fruitful disciples. And Jesus never set out for him as one person to go into all the world. He chose 12 men, and those 12 men scattered out and impacted the world for Jesus. So tonight, I've asked Stephen to come and share how he and his world is trying to make an impact through the ministry that God has given him. And I was sharing with him out there in the lobby a moment ago as we talked. I said, you know the story of the feeding of the 5,000? There's one person in that story that kind of gets overlooked, and we don't know his name, but he was really, to me, kind of the hero of the story, the little boy. He provided the ingredients that Jesus used to feed that multitude. And I said, Steve, what kind of, to me, you're doing, sharing with us, God has given you a ministry. You know, baseball, that doesn't seem like a very big thing, but he's sharing by going from the job he had down to baseball country, God is using him to make an impact in that corner of the world. So I'll let you introduce your family, Stephen, and y'all listen, and tonight ask yourself, what can I do in my corner of the world to make a difference? And this is Stephen Franklin. He's from North Fort Baptist. And brother, just share what's on your heart.
This song?
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so tonight I have Christy, my wife, my beautiful wife that is, sorry, she's in the back of my life. To encounter Jesus, and I'm very thankful for that. All right. Cora, my 13-year-old, she just turned 13. And Meg Hudson just turned 10 a couple weeks ago. And we have little Ford in the back. And I don't know Pastor Tim too well. We've only been around each other a couple times. And I look forward to getting to know you more. But one thing I do know is Pastor Tim had a son who was making an impact on the kingdom. And I'm assuming that started at home. And when I went to David's memorial service, I'd eat lunch with him. And He came and shared at our church one time, so I saw him a couple times. And I knew he was an awesome man, but I didn't really know until I went to the memorial service. And you saw the impact that he made on all these guys. All these men got up and they testified to the impact and the investment that he made in their life, in their family's life. And, you know, as a father, I think that's probably the best compliment you can receive of achievement, is if your children are going out and being like arrows, shooting arrows for Christ, going out and making an impact on the world for the kingdom of God. And I think that's something that's really missing in our nation, is men are not man enough in following Jesus. Because when we do that, everything changes. And unfortunately, when man does not do it, who's left to do it? Usually mom, right? Well, God didn't design mom to lead the family spiritually. He designed man to do it. And unfortunately, even though I was brought up in church, you know, I wasn't leading our family spiritually. I knew what I needed to do. But my wife was stepping up and leading our family when Hudson, I think he was under a year old, and we moved here to town. Christy was fulfilling that role. And I'm so glad she did. But through that, God really got my attention that I had to step up and be a man, and I had to lead my family. But I couldn't do it because I hadn't surrendered my life to the Lord. So just going back a little bit, you know, I grew up in church. And I was such a fortunate boy to have two parents who loved Jesus. Their love for Jesus transcended all their relationships. It transcended how they loved me and my sister, Brandy. It transcended how they loved each other. It transcended how they loved strangers. And when I was 7, they went into full-time ministry with little kids called the Big Oak Ranch. I don't know if you've ever heard of that, but they were house parents for 2 years at the boys' ranch, and we had 7 brothers, so I was in heaven as a 7-year-old, having all these boys to play with. And when John decided to start a girls' ranch, he asked to be the director, so we moved when I was 9 and a half, I believe, to Springville, and that's kind of where I grew up most of my life. So for me, I got to see a picture of Jesus Christ through my parents, you know, and that's what God designed it to be like, you know, and it's not happening. And I think that's one of the reasons we have the problems that we do have. But even though I saw that, I didn't realize it like I realize it today, how fortunate I was. As a child, I didn't really understand that. So I made a decision for Christ when I was 9 years old. Walked down the aisle, confessed, was baptized. But I was never in pursuit of the Lord. I was never opening up the only way to know who Jesus Christ is. I knew the answers. We were always in church. I knew the right answers. I wanted to be a good boy. I wanted to honor my parents. I wanted to honor the Lord. But I was doing it in my own strength because I had not surrendered to the Lord. I knew I wanted heaven. I didn't want hell. And I think if you ask anybody in the church, and I think this is kind of where it stops or it has in the past, you know, you have all these converts, but you're not discipling them to know who Jesus Christ is, to know who you are. In your flesh, we're all evil, and we all deserve hell. I'm brought up by the Holy Spirit and through Christ. If we don't have that, we deserve hell. So we don't really understand the weight of our sin, I don't think, or I did not. I didn't realize, you know, I understood I put Jesus on the cross, but, you know, you look at other people, you compare yourself to the murderer, the rapist, all these people, you know, I did it too, okay? So I'm not better than anybody else. So anyway, as a child, I always thought I would get serious about my walk with the Lord when I get older. And I don't know why I thought that, but that was kind of foolish. So like I said, I never pursued God. I was never really in His Word other than when my parents were making me. Although my parents showed me. I saw them in the mornings read God's Word. I saw them living it out in their life. I saw it, but it's my choice, right? You can't get to heaven on the coattails of your parents. It's your choice. Kids, it's your choice. You have to choose. Doesn't matter how faithful your parents are. So I continued in that I'll get to it later mentality as an adolescent, and went to college, and I thought I was a pretty good kid until I got on my own, and I thought, man, I'm free to you know, do some things I've never done before. Nobody's around. So I'm going to try this or that or the other. And, you know, that freedom that I thought I had became bondage to my flesh. I was a slave to my flesh. And when you read God's word, it starts clicking pretty quick. So anyway, through college, you know, I knew I was doing wrong, right? I understood that. So I started distancing myself from Campus Crusade, different activities where I was going to be around people who would be iron for me, who would help me, push me towards Jesus. So I didn't want to be around it. I got away from going to church. You know, I wasn't talking to the Lord. It was a really, really dark place in my life. And anyway, through all that, you know, even in my sin and doing what I want to do, you know, I met my future wife, Christy. And unfortunately, we were not living for the Lord either. So, through all that, fast forward, we have two children, and Christy rededicated her life. We were burying at the time. I say she surrendered her life to the Lord. And I noticed a difference in my wife. She was pursuing God, she was in His Word. She always had Christian music on the radio. I get in a car to go somewhere, and I would hear the Christian music all the time. And it just got me angry. You know, I was like, I don't want to listen to this, you know. And, you know, when your wife, you know, I knew what I should be doing, she was doing it, you know. So I felt a little ashamed. And she would always say, Stephen, we need to raise our kids in church. Well, I knew that. But I was still trying to be a boy instead of a man. So I was dragging my feet. So we moved to Tuscaloosa, and one Wednesday I was in Atlanta working. Come back home, and Christy, I was coming back, and I said, I don't know if I'm going to make it in time for church. And she'd been telling me, we got to get to church. So I think we'd gone to Northport Baptist a couple times, and of course in day school, and this Wednesday night she wanted to fellowship, meet some people in the church. And I said, I don't know if I'm going to make it. I'm running kind of late. And she had enough. She was like, well, I don't care if you make it or not. I'm taking the kids to church. You know, she was putting her foot down, which she likes to do from time to time. And I'm thankful for that because she really got my attention. So that really, you know, God really got my attention to where, man, it kind of hurt a little bit hearing your wife tell you that. So I get coming across the Millport Bridge, and Satan is really just sitting there saying, man, just go home. It's been a long day. And the Holy Spirit's pounding my heart. Pounding me and saying, Stephen, you have to leave your family. Christy can't do it. You know, she can try. She can do a good job trying, but I designed you to do it. So I get off the bridge, making it in church, sit down in the men's Bible study, sit right in the middle, and the guy, lo and behold, what do you think he's talking about? You got to be the spiritual leader of your home, okay? So God just slapped me in the face. I mean, he'd been knocking on the door of my heart forever, and I kept running. And anyway, he really got my attention. And from that point on, I started to pursue the Lord. I started to get in His Word. God started putting men in my life who were investing in me for the kingdom, investing in me and showing me why it was important to surrender your life to the Lord, for your wife, for your kids, for everybody you come in contact with. You know, people's life are on the line for eternity, based on our decisions. And you know, we're all impacting other people, like you were talking about. We're either impacting them for good or for bad. Everybody's making an impact. So anyway, from that point forward, you know, I started pursuing the Lord. God started doing stuff in our family. He started showing Himself to me. He started doing things, you know, that didn't really make sense and pointed back to Him. So we get to 2018, and everything's clicking along pretty good. We go to this dinner for baseball country. It's a fundraiser. Our church bought two tables, and we're sitting there, never heard of this place before. And these people are getting up, and they're testifying to the impact of this ministry on their life. You know, you saw coaches get up in a little video conference talking about their team coming through a team camp. You saw a grandmother get up and talk about her grandson coming through a youth camp. You saw two parents get up and testify to their son coming through the travel ball summer stuff. And then you saw this kid from Greene County in the projects get up. You know, he couldn't string any sentences together, but he got up there and he had several paragraphs written out. And he had the nerve to get up, the boldness to get up and share the impact that this guy had made on his life, Sam Marchand, who runs Baseball Country. And I was kind of floored. And then you hear about the testimony of Sam and Kristen, how they left everything in Tampa to come to Gina, Alabama. And I was like, this isn't about baseball, this is about Jesus. So at that point in time, I was really in pursuit of the Lord. I was growing, and I was encouraged because you see somebody living out their faith. You know, you don't see that every day. I'm talking about living it out where you're putting it on the line for Jesus. You don't know how it's going to look on the other end, but you go anyway. You step out of the boat because he's called you to go. So I was encouraged. I was like, man, this is awesome. And we're like, we got to hear more about this. So we went and had dinner at Baseball Country with Sam and Crystal one night. And, man, just hearing their testimony, how God called them, how they left everything. His wife's a doctor. He had two automotive shops at the time. And not only did they hear the call from God, but they came. They moved and left everything, all their comfort, their family, to come to Gina. So again, I was encouraged, but I was also challenged because I was asking myself, you know, what is my faith really costing me? And I think that's something we all need to ask ourselves. Is your faith costing you anything? Anything? So, and I was like, there's a lot of grass to be cut out here. And I was like, we don't have any money, but I can help Sam with a weed eating. So I don't know if it was the next day or that weekend, I came back out there with a weed eater and just started helping him work and just developed a relationship with Sam, and was really challenged by how he really stepped out in faith. In every situation of his life, he was always stepping out and just trusting God, and got to know him really well. And anyway, they purchased 2019, January 1, they actually purchased Baseball Country. They were working for another missionary group at the time. So through that, he asked me if I'd be on the board. And I was like, man, that's a privilege to be on the board. So Baseball Country is a place where they use baseball and softball, and we have a hunting ministry also, but we use these different things, mainly baseball and softball, to tell the truth about who Jesus Christ is and what he's done for all of us. And it's an easy way to get kids out there. But through that, we have team camps. So you might have a football team, a basketball team, or a baseball team come through and do some team building exercises. And really, what Sam tries to do is put them through some intense situations to really uncover what's in their heart and then explain to them what the answer is. So they have team camps, youth retreats, we have father-son retreats, a men's retreat, and we have three travel teams in the summer that go and compete. Right now we have 25 kids that are in the back staying throughout the summer. There's some from Orlando, Tampa, South Alabama. We have 8 Dominican kids that are there. And it's so awesome to have opportunities to share Jesus with all these kids. And they're from all different backgrounds, some from good homes, some from broken homes, some from nothing, you know. But anyway, there's so much different stuff that's going on, and it's such a, I call it a privilege to be able to be a part of it. So last year, I guess, last April 2020, or before that, really before that, Christy was, you know, I don't know about you, men, but sometimes God talks to my wife before he talks to me. And Christy kept saying, I think God wants, you know, I was on the board at the time. She said, I think God wants us to give him more, to do something bigger than what we're doing now. And she's kind of a dreamer and all this big stuff, and I'm kind of the logical guy, one step in front of the other. Let's, you know, look, I'm on board here. You're out there with the softball, and we're involved at church. You know, what else? We want to go be a missionary. What's going on? So anyway, this verse kept appearing and appearing. And this was over probably a couple of years, right? Before we even met Sam and him. But it's Ephesians 3:20, and it says, "Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us." And that verse kept popping up and popping up. And she kept saying, I think God wants got something bigger for us. So at the time, I was working at Alabama Steel Components. Been here for 10 years in Tuscaloosa, and everything was going great with my job. I worked my way up to VP over operations, and you know, if we want to go on vacation, we could go on vacation. There's no worries with that. And there were some other opportunities coming up that my boss was going to go into some other avenues that were going to be lucrative opportunities for us. And so from the worldly standpoint, everything was good, right? For the American dream standpoint, everything was good. But anyway, so this verse keeps popping up, and then I start seeing it too. And we are seeing God do things in baseball country that point back to Him doing them. And that's what's cool, is when you see when man's not scheming, but when man's just obeying what God's called him to do, and you see God lining all this stuff up, and it's apparent that He's at work. I mean, I don't know about you, but as a believer, follower of Christ, that's encouraging, right? Because it points back to Him. And what does He want? He wants all of what? The glory, right? So we continue to see that over and over, you know, out of baseball country. And that winter, Sam asked me, have you guys ever thought about getting into full-time ministry? Now, I mean, my parents were in full-time ministry. I always said, I'm never going to do that, you know. But as I've gotten to know who Jesus Christ is and what He not wants, what He demands of my life as a follower, it's apparent that it's not about my comfort. It's not about my American dream and being comfortable with all my stuff. It's about His kingdom. I mean, that's apparent. If you read God's Word, you go to the New Testament, that's what it's all about. And so Sam asked me, hey, you ever thought about getting into full-time ministry? Because he's like, I think you have a heart for these kids. One more thing, back up. Sam has a heart for these kids that have no fathers. Okay, so we go to the projects and branch heights in Utah, Alabama. I forget, there's 285 or so many units. There's 5 live-in dads. So you see, what I was talking about earlier, when man's not aligned with God, okay, when we're not doing our part, and we're not being men being responsible, there's chaos all over the place. I mean, you don't have to be really smart to see that, right? It's all over. It doesn't matter if it's in the project or if it's in a rich neighborhood. Dad can be at home, but he cannot be at home, right? And I actually had this conversation at lunch with my daughter. She was telling me I work too much, so I got to look in the mirror on that one, right? We have to be available. We can't be all about our work or hobbies or whatever. So anyway, there's a lot of kids that we're trying to invest in that have no one invested in them. And there's a lot of churches that aren't going to invest in them, maybe because they've had a bad experience or whatever. So they're on an island by themselves. So anyway, back to what Sam asked me. We're sitting around the little campfire and he asked me that. And I said, yeah, you know, I have been thinking about that. I've been wrestling with this in my heart about getting something full-time ministry-wise. But I was like, Sam, I'm scared to death, I'll be honest with you, man. And he said, all I can tell you is freedom. It's so freeing when you're walking in whatever it is that God's called you to do. And when you go, there's freedom in that. And I said, yeah, I know, but I said, I'm just scared. And what I was really afraid about was how am I going to provide for my family? I think if you ask any of the men in here, there's a responsibility on our shoulders too. We have to provide for our family, right? So how's that going to happen if I come over here? And he said, well, just pray about it, man. He said, I don't know what it looks like. I didn't play college baseball. I played professional ball. I wasn't some high school coach. So it doesn't really fit the mold. What are you going to do out here? But he said, I know you have a heart for the lost. So anyways, I was praying about it. Hutch and I were hunting. It's the last day of hunting season and last weekend. And he sent me a text and he said, hey, keep praying. And I said, yeah, man, I'm praying. There was some kids coming in for a teen camp. He said, yeah, I'm praying for the kids that they'll see the truth, hear the truth, and receive it. And he said, no, no, no. Keep praying for God's will for your life. for your family. I said, yeah, I hadn't prayed about that today. I said, okay, I need to pray about that. So as we're sitting there in the shooting house, Hudson's asleep, of course. And I start calling out to God and saying, God, and I felt in my heart, I knew what he wanted us to do. But I always liked that big blinking sign that says, Stephen, you idiot, go this way. So anyway, I was like, God, just show me the clarity of what you want us to do. Please just show me. And I started looking at my emails for work. And I came across an email my dad had sent me earlier in the week. We had the fundraiser, and Sam asked me for Baseball Country. He asked me to get up at the very end and share the impact of Baseball Country on my heart, or on my family and everything. So anyway, I'm reading this email that Dad sent me. And he said, hey, he's kind of patting me on the back, saying, I'm proud of you and Christy for how you're leading your family, your kids. And he's talking about being involved in Baseball Country. But he said, it wasn't until me and Mom went into full-time ministry that we saw the eternal impact that God wanted to make through our lives. And he titled the email, Giving Yourself. So I'm like, oh man. So and then he said something in there about freedom. And I'm like, God's talking to me, you know. And I don't know about you, but if you hear God speaking to you directly, not audibly, but you know he's speaking to you, it's pretty humbling. I think it is. Creator of the universe is going to speak to you. So as I'm sitting there reading that, man, I start bawling. You know, I'm like, I was kind of overwhelmed. So anyway, I sent Christy a text, and I was like, I think his parent God wants us to go into full-time ministry. And he wants me to quit my job and go to Baseball Country. I don't even know what that looks like, what that means. But he's showing me that's what he wants us to do. And she felt the same way. And I was like, and this is awesome, but it's frightening too, right? Because we're right here with what we're making, and we're going to, I don't even know where we're going. How's it going to work? Okay, I'm driving a company truck. I got to go, we have to go get a vehicle. We have one vehicle and a company truck, so I'm going to have to go purchase a vehicle. How's this going to work? So my flesh is saying this is not a great idea, but the Holy Spirit is saying, go, you know? So anyway, Christy said, you know, later on she was like, I'm going to pray that your boss gives you that truck. And I said, Christy, he likes money too much. He's not going to give me the truck that I was driving. So anyways, when I finally got the nerve to tell Jason and his wife that we were going to have to answer this call and I was going to have to quit my job, you know, I've been with him for 10 years. I was worried how he was going to respond to it. And he came to the dinner too, where I got up and spoke. So I'm sitting there telling Kelly and Jason, hey, God's called Christy and I to go to Baseball Country. And I can't ignore it. I can't run from it. I've got to go. And Kelly is sitting there smiling, and she said, you know, after the dinner, Jason and I looked at each other, and we said, Stephen's about to get into this full time. So God already spoke to their heart that this is something I was passionate about. So that was really encouraging. And then Jason, the first thing he said was, you're going to need a truck, aren't you? I said, yes, sir, I am. And he said, well, do you want to buy this truck? I said, if I can afford it, sure. So he told me the payoff amount, and it was nothing compared to what the worth of the vehicle. And I was like, yeah, I'd love to purchase the truck. That'd be great. So I'm leaving the office. I called my best friend in Birmingham that I've been talking to about this move. And I said, hey, man, Kelly, we did it. I told my boss we're all in. It's a done deal. And he said, he didn't give you that truck, did he? I said, no, he didn't, but he might as well. It's for nothing, basically. It's $21,000 and some change. He said, I'll tell you what. He said, I'm going to buy a truck for you. He said, I'm going to pay for your truck. And I was like, no, man, I'm not calling you to get help. I'll just let you know we're doing it. He said, no, that's how I want to start helping you. Start helping you. So I was like, you know, the shallow thing I was worried about is how am I going to provide for my family? Not thinking God's going to make it work out one way or the other. And then God, you know, right out of the gate, day one, your truck's paid for, you know? And, you know, things like that, God continues to do. continues to do. And out of baseball country, sometimes it's month to month. You know, it can be really tough. Now, for example, last fall, we had a MLB a pro players retreat. There was 18 current players or former players that came, and they did a retreat. They usually do an international retreat, but it's a Christian organization through MLB, but they couldn't because of COVID, so they came to baseball country, and they were going to go to Aliceville, to Utah, Alabama, and to Northport, and do these camps for free. It's no charge. So we have no money basically in the account, and Sam and I are at the little hunt property, and we're putting up the shooting house, and I said, Sam, how are we going to, so he's going to get 500 t-shirts, 500 hot dogs, 500 drinks, 500 chips. I was like, how are we going to afford this, man? He said, God's going to provide. I said, I know, but how? I'd like to see the picture, how this is going to work. So we were sitting out there putting that up, and his wife sent him a text and said, somebody from our church just came by and dropped off a check. And there was a couple in our church, their parents, one of the parents passed away, and they were bringing some of that money, the inheritance. They had no idea what our situation was, but God was lining that up. So it was enough money to pay for the shirts, the hot dogs, the drinks, the chips, and plus a little extra. And God, that's what he continues to do. He's always doing immeasurably more than all we can ask or imagine. And at that retreat, you know, one of the best memories I have since I've been in baseball country, when we presented the gospel in Northport, I got to pray with two kids to receive Christ. And we're sitting out there in the outfield, this little boy, his name's Holt, and I'm explaining the gospel to him, and he's getting it and understanding everything. And we pray, and anyway, we're about to leave the park, and his dad comes up to me, and he's got tears in his eyes. And he took a picture of me and Hope kneeling down to pray. And he said, I don't really know how this, what I'm going to say to him on the way home. He said, we've never really talked about that. And I was like, well, he understood everything I was talking about, but you need to follow up with him for sure. And he was really stressed out, and I was like, hey, can I pray with you real quick? I'll pray with you. And anyway, it just meant a lot to be able to make an investment in a son and then be able to talk to his father. I mean, it was fulfilling, you know what I'm saying? And the joy of knowing, that's why we're there. I'm not there for baseball. I'm there to invest in these kids. So I go to Pickens County, to Carrollton every Wednesday, getting to know these kids. A lot of them, you know, they get out of high school and they're just hanging out at their house doing nothing. So I'm trying to encourage them with truth, with God's truth, tell them that they got to be a man, they got to get up and go to work, they can't just hang out, and try to give them opportunities to come to baseball country to work and get some money too. So there's all kinds of different things. I'm not a great speaker, so I can't always tie it all together, but there's a lot of things that are going on within baseball country. We always have the need for people to come out and help and serve. That's one thing we've been praying about is, Lord, please send more workers. You know, these guys that are down there right now, we're cooking breakfast, lunch, dinner for 25 people. We have projects out at baseball country, different things, depending on your skill level, things that you can do to help. Or if we go do a service project down in the projects or the downtown square of Utah or in Pickens County or whatever, any church that wanted to come be a part of that can do that as well. But I guess to wrap everything up, you know, God's really made it apparent to me that as a follower of Christ, it's my job to invest in other people for eternity. And as I've grown my relationship with Him, and you can look back in your life and you can see little things where He's preparing you for the next thing, you know. And every time He asks you to do something, it's always going to be uncomfortable. That's what we have to realize. The only way you can grow, I can grow, is if we let go and we allow God to work through the situation. And it doesn't matter what it is. It's getting up and speaking in front of people, or going and befriending somebody, or forgiving somebody. Whatever it is, it's going to be hard. And he promises in his word, if you're going to follow me, it's not easy, right? It's hard. It's hard to follow Jesus because we have to deny what? Our flesh. Our flesh is selfish. So we have to deny our flesh every day. We've never arrived. And I have a passion to encourage other men to get busy living for Jesus for the sake of their family. Because I was not doing that for a long time. I was 33 before I said, yes, Jesus, I want to do it your way. I'm tired of doing it my way. So I have a burning desire in my heart to point other men, hey, it's time to get, there's too much on the line for you to keep doing it your way. And you see all these kids that have no fathers. I mean, I can't imagine if I didn't have a father in my life, especially one that's pointing me to Jesus. But they're out there everywhere. So who has to fill the gap? It's us as the church. The people who know the truth and who believe the truth. And we'll know if we believe it by what? Our fruit. The fruit that God's producing in us, not anything of us. So I encourage you to get uncomfortable for Jesus. You know, and you talk about the discipleship part. You know, I was really weary of doing that because I don't feel like I'm qualified to lead a group per se, right? I don't feel like I know enough of God's word. I don't know. I like to be the guy sitting in the back instead of the guy sitting at the podium talking. And, you know, God keeps putting different guys in my life, you know, like Danny and so many other guys that are iron, you know, and you have to surround yourself with people who are in pursuit of Jesus. As iron sharpens iron, so one man sharpens another. I mean, that's the truth. And I'm so thankful for Danny and his family. And for little Elliot, he's been a little iron for my boy, you know. And when you see people who are pursuing Jesus, you can see it in their life. I mean, yeah, ain't nobody faking anybody out. It's coming out of you. That's the power of the Holy Spirit. It changes you. So if we're not seeing any fruits of the Spirit coming out of us, we got to check ourselves and say, do I believe this? Because the power of the Holy Spirit hasn't changed, right? When the power that rose Jesus from the grave is living in me, but I can't forgive somebody? What? I can't get uncomfortable and go help somebody that can't help me back and show them love as divine in the Bible? What? If you have the power of the Holy Spirit, you can do that. And it's not hard. It's a privilege to do it, right? So I encourage you to get uncomfortable, and whenever God calls you to do whatever it is for His glory, just go do it. Just go do it. That's about all I got. Sorry.
Good job. I'd like for us just to take a moment to reflect on what we've heard. And just think of one thing that God maybe spoke to you about tonight, and I got a couple of things I want to say to wrap up, okay? Let's just bow and think about this. Think about what God has spoken to us through Stephen tonight, and just kind of talk to God for just a moment. Father God, may we do what we've been reminded of tonight. In Jesus' name, amen. Y'all know what Baseball Country is, a local mission project that we can be supportive of and pray for and be involved in. Also, do all of y'all know what he was referring to? His parents served at. John Quarle was an All-American ball player under Bear Bryant and started Big Old Branch. And when I was here before, it was real big. John was ready to go play professional football, and he realized God was calling him to take care of children, young people and young adults that were in trouble. And even Bear Bryant told him, he said, you go follow your heart, do what's right. And that was an awesome ministry, and I've followed that over the years and all. Anybody got a question before we go for Stephen? Because this is something we need to all be interested in praying for locally here down to Gina. I don't even know where that's at. It's down close to the Falls, right?
Right.
All right. So I'm just learning about it myself. Anybody got a question?
Yeah, I got something. If anybody wants to get involved in any way, you can talk to me or Chrissy, but she has a volunteer sign-up list.
Okay.
Based on people that have done it in the past. I think she has an email address, but so she'll send out an email to everybody that's on the list. So, hey, we have a need for cooking on Thursday, 6 o'clock or whatever.
Okay.
And people can go on there and sign up. It's really easy.
Okay.
If you want to do something like that.
You got your list ready tonight or just?
I have it on my phone.
Okay, all right.
We always need people to cook.
All right. Great. That's a good thing then. Anybody else? A couple of reminders. Remember, Thursday week, senior adults, we're going to meet for our first senior adult meeting. Also, I mentioned there's a Promise Keepers rally. It's actually at AT&T Stadium in Dallas or Fort Worth on the 16th and 17th, but that's a long way off. There's going to be a local simulcast of that at Carroll's Creek. If you're interested in going, men, $20, and you can sign up out there on the table. Promise Keepers was at one time a tremendous ministry to men. It kind of took a dip, but it's coming back now. And it's nothing like seeing 80 or 100,000 men praising Jesus together. And so if you're interested in going, put your name on that list so we'll know. Also, this coming Wednesday night, we're going to have a discussion on improving our ministry to young adults here at Buell. And so you'll want to be a part of that. And so I encourage you to make a point to be here this Wednesday night. And anything else before we go? Brother, you touched my heart. Thank you so much for that. Great testimony, great story. And let's close. Father, we love you in Jesus' name. May we do great things for you according to your plan, not ours, as we go forward from the time. In Jesus' name, amen. Good night.